West Germany was the largest operator of the F-104 Starfighter, having purchased 915 of them. That is 35% of the total number of Starfighters manufactured. However, at the same time, the German armed forces had the worst safety record among the 15 other countries that operated the F-104. As a matter of fact, Germany lost 292 Starfighters during its operational history, almost a third of its Starfighters. In addition to the aircraft lost, Germany also lost 116 pilots, including 8 Americans, during its service. The accident rate of the F-104 in the Luftwaffe and in the German Navy was so bad that the plane earned the nickname Widowmaker in Germany, and that some pilots even had to eject twice during their careers. In this video, let's take a look at why the accident rate of the German F-104s was so high and what factors contributed to it. But first, a little bit of historic context. In 1956, the German Ministry of Defense created a plan to acquire 2,000 aircraft and have them distributed in 20 wings across the country in the next 5 years. Due to the logistical and financial reasons, it was decided that the German Air Force and Navy would only be able to operate one aircraft. Requirements for this aircraft included Mach 2 capability, ability to carry both conventional and nuclear armaments, be an all-weather aircraft, and be an aircraft that is in at least a pre-production stage. Amongst the aircraft considered, we have the Dassault Mirage 3A, the F-111F-1F Super Tiger, which were both in the evaluation and test phase respectively, and the F-104 that was just entering service in the United States Air Force. It is important to mention that the American version of the F-104 didn't meet the all-weather requirement, but given that Lockheed promised to make a special variant for it, the Germans chose the Starfighter. However, there were problems, actually many of them. Let's take a look at a graph that compares the number of accidents to the hours flown by the German starfighters. As you can see, the columns on the left side show an atrociously high accident rate in the early years of the F-104. However, for both 1961 and 1962, we need to take into account that there were very few F-104s in service. Delivery of the F-104s began in 1960, which you can see in the graph that there was a very good year since there was no accident. The next 2 years are misleading though, because there were only 2 accidents in 1961 and 7 accidents in 1962. And because there were few aircraft operational at the time, the number of flight hours was small, which ends up greatly increasing the accident rate. Talking about 1962 in special, 4 F-104s were lost in the same accident during that year. The 4 aircraft were performing a formation training flight when their flight leader put the aircraft in a maneuver that they couldn't recover, and the 4 aircraft ended up crashing on the ground, killing the 4 pilots. Because of that, the German Air Force never formed an aerobatic squadron again. From 1965 to 1966 is when the accident rate actually got really serious. 48 aircraft were lost in the 2 years, and this resulted in a leadership crisis within the Luftwaffe. Some measures were taken in 1966 when the Luftwaffe appointed a new chief of staff, and the accident rate gradually decreased to an average of 2 aircraft lost per year, which was along the lines of the other countries that operated the F-104. In addition to showing how many accidents there were from 1960 to 1989, I have also read the details of 287 out of the 292 accidents, and here's a breakdown on what caused them. Of course, it goes without saying that each accident is usually a combination of several factors, but for the sake of simplicity, I have divided them on what was the primary factor that caused the accident. The most common one was pilot error, responsible for 105 or 37% of the accidents. In this category, the most common mention in the details of the accidents were spatial disorientation and pilots who misjudged their ground attack and could not pull up from their dive. In second place, we have issues with the aircraft, responsible for 102 or 35% of the accidents. One of the problems I had while taking a look at the details of the accidents was identifying if they had been caused by design flaws and manufacturing issues, or if it was due to poor maintenance of the aircraft. Most common reasons in this category include engine failures, problems with the fuel flow, oil, flaps and hydraulic systems, and also, to a smaller extent, aircraft catching fire on the ground. Responsible for 17 accidents, we have the weather, mainly due to lightning strikes that disabled the instruments of the aircraft, and lastly we have 63 accidents that go by the other category, which includes bird strikes, the ingestion of foreign objects on the engine, and so on. As you see, contrary to popular belief, the majority of the losses of the German F-104s wasn't because of a design flaw of the aircraft. Instead, it was caused by other factors and most commonly a combination of them. Now, why did these accidents happen and why is pilot error ranked number one in the causes? Let's take a look. First, one of the main problems with the whole German F-104 program was that it was too rushed and too ambitious. There was an enormous pressure on West Germany to contribute troops to NATO and to build up its air force. As I mentioned before, they had a plan of operating 2,000 aircraft in 5 years in 20 different wings, and this brings me to my next point. The Luftwaffe was a young and inexperienced air force when they proposed the plan I've just mentioned, and the same can be said about its pilots, especially when it comes to modern jet aircraft. It is important to mention that this isn't the same Luftwaffe that fought during the Second World War, which ceased to exist in 1945. However, some of its veterans did return when the new Luftwaffe was established in 1956 after an 11-year break. We must also consider the huge jump in terms of technology and performance between the F-104, a Mach 2 capable jet fighter, and the F-84 or the Seahawk, which were operated by the German Air Force and Navy respectively. Training is also another factor to consider because German F-104 pilots were trained in two separate locations, Germany itself and the American Southwest. Many German pilots train in the US together with American instructors because of airspace restrictions in Europe and also because of the very different climates, since in the American Southwest, pilots enjoyed a flying weather almost every day and had much more airspace and training areas available for them. Of course, though, that when pilots had trained in optimal conditions in the United States, they faced some difficulty of adjusting to the German climate and airspace once they returned to their country. And I should also mention that some operations conducted in Germany included flying at very low level at high speed in poor weather conditions, which, as you know, is the perfect recipe for an accident. Another aspect worth mentioning is the unavailability of planes. There were very few trainer versions of the F-104 in Germany, and because of that, training in the weapon systems would only take place when the pilots reached their operational unit. And guess what happened when pilots finished their training and reached their units? There were few to no F-104 at their units. To put it shortly, there weren't enough Starfighters in both training and operational units, and in order to avoid the decay of their flying proficiency, the pilots started flying the older F-86s and the F-84s just to keep themselves current. The lack of planes is exemplified by the comments of Joachim Zieger, a former German F-104 pilot. "We were scheduled to receive the brand new Starfighters right after handing over the F-84s. However, that plan did not work. In the meantime, we were allowed to fly the odd backseat ride in the F-104F just to get the feeling while we were desperately waiting for our own Gustav. To keep us busy, our superiors thought of all kinds of different tasks and subjects. Daily sports like volleyball, discussion about historical battles, or the establishment of a pilot choir. The most expensive choir in the world, consisting of 20 pilots, each of whom had finished a $250,000 training course, was in top condition and received standing ovations." In addition to the lack of Starfighters, there was also a lack of support equipment that also includes spare parts and trained mechanics that could work on the plane. Lastly, we should also consider the operational use of the F-104 by Germany. While the aircraft was designed primarily as a high-speed fighter, Germany used it to pretty much everything, including interceptions, reconnaissance, air superiority, nuclear delivery, and ground attack missions. And from what I have seen in the accident records, several pilots lost their lives while trying to pull up from a dive. That kind of accident, of course, falls under pilot error, since it was the pilot's decision to judge speed, dive angle, and altitude to pull up. But it's important to remember the F-104 wasn't initially designed as an attacker. Now that we know the reasons behind the accidents, let's see how Germany dealt with them. The year of 1966 was the most important year of the Starfighter crisis. Both the German government and population were pressuring the Luftwaffe due to an alarming rate of Starfighter accidents. Because of this, General Lieutenant Johann Steinhoff became the new Chief of Air Staff. With his new position, Steinhoff grounded all German Starfighters for 3 weeks so that inspections and improvements could be performed on the aircraft's ejection seat, canopies, and the automatic pitch control. In addition, The following measures were proposed to be taken immediately, still in the year of 1966. The installation of rocket packs in the C-2 ejection seats, which was still a downward firing seat. The installation of hook barriers and approach lightning systems with sequenced flashing lights at German air bases. The improvement of sea survival equipment, the speed up of the disbandment of the F-84 units to increase manpower of the F-104 units, an increase in the number of pilots per squadron, and an increase in industrial and maintenance support for these squadrons. Already in 1967, 1 year after the new measures had taken place, the German accident rate for the F-104 dropped significantly to 2.4 accidents per 10,000 flying hours, which was about the same as the other NATO countries that operated the Starfighters. In addition to the measures mentioned before, the downward ejection seat was finally upgraded to an upward ejection seat, namely the Martin Baker GQ-7A in 1968, which was extremely helpful to increase pilot survivability, since in previous accidents, pilots would many times hesitate to eject due to low altitude and try to crash land their plane since they had the downward fire ejection seat. Also, a notable mention is that in 1969, Steinhoff won in making the German parliament approve a new regulation where pilots of fast jets in both the Air Force and Navy had to remain in service until they became 40 years old, so that the Air Force would not lose experienced pilots, something that was also helpful in reducing the accident rate in later years. So, in order to summarize why Germany had the highest accident rates of all countries that operated the F-104 Starfighter, here's a quote from a former German F-104 pilot. "There was hardly a week without a crash, and the German Air Force was, in the end, willing to accept help and advice from outside." During 1966, the then Deputy Supreme Allied Commander of Europe, Marshal of the Royal Air Force, Sir Thomas Pike, looked at the problem. His conclusion was as follows. "High political pressure to supply NATO with a substantial force to meet the German commitment as part of the nuclear deterrent, lack of experience with advanced weapon systems such as the F-104 due to the long break between 1945 and 1956, both in respect to the pilots and the engineers, not enough flying hours for daily training, and Air Force top leaders without extensive flying experience. From his point of view, this was a dangerous combination, which was bound to lead for a high loss rate." Now, before we finish this video, I thought I would share with you some three interesting points I have encountered during my research. First, because of the lack of trainer F-104s, the Germans would put the nose section of the F-104G with its radar on the Douglas C-47 so that the Air Force could train three pilots at the same time on how to use the radar. Second, the first German to ever fly solo on an F-104 was Günther Hall, a veteran pilot of the Luftwaffe that fought during the Second World War with 275 claimed kills and ranks third in the world ranking for air kills. He joined the Luftwaffe in 1956 and was tasked to oversee the German F-104 program and training. And finally, I should also mention another ace, Eric Hartmann, with 352 claimed kills. Just like Hall, he joined the new Luftwaffe, but unlike him, Hartmann opposed the whole German F-104 program, saying that Germany didn't need it nor its pilots could handle the F-104 since they lacked experience. His attitude of voicing his concerns against the program due to the safety considerations wasn't very popular amongst the top brass of the Luftwaffe, and he ultimately was forced to retire in 1970. Before we finish this video, please like and share if you enjoyed this content, or go ahead and dislike if you didn't. All my sources are in the description, and if you are interested in this kind of video, you can check this playlist. And please also consider supporting me on Patreon so I can buy more books for research. This was Ace Combat Fan, hope you have enjoyed this video, and see you next time!